Karibu kwa bishop. Karibu sana.
Thank you very much. We want to begin on the program. Our topic is ministry within Anglicanism or within Anglican Church. And let me begin by reading the article on the ministry. The church is the body of Christ upon earth, and to it
has been committed the task of continuing
and completing all that Jesus began both to do and to teach. Those words come from Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 1. It is therefore the purpose of this church in all her ministries, pastoral, prophetic, and priestly, to be conformed to the likeness of Jesus Christ, who is himself the good shepherd, the living word of God, and the heavenly high priest. Yesterday I said that ministry within Anglicanism is ordered ministry, meaning you don't just wake up and say, today I'm a lay reader, tomorrow you say I'm an archdeacon, the next day you say I'm a rector, the other day you say I'm an apostle. Our ministry within the church is ordered. May I also say that it is very, very clear for the Anglican Church of Kenya, and I believe most of the realms, that the church has specific ministries. The main purpose for the church is to continue what Jesus began to do and to teach. Meaning, our purpose is to continue the mission of Christ. Our purpose, therefore, is to fulfill the will of God for mankind. And we want to say that yesterday I reminded you that gospel in Anglicanism is the paschal mystery that we celebrate, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. And that therefore means that when we want to continue what Jesus began to do and to teach, we are continuing the work of reconciliation. And I believe that is why the message we got this morning is very, very important. Because there is no way you can continue to reconcile the world if you yourself are not reconciled to God. So our first responsibility is to be reconciled to God. Secondly, we have to be reconciled to one another so that we can become the church, the body of Christ. Without reconciliation, there is no believer. Without reconciliation, there is no church. There is no body of believers. So we need to know that our main work is to bring reconciliation. And therefore, in our ministry, we must always let God's agenda be our agenda. And the way that the ministry is ordered within Anglicanism is easy to help us to realize that this work is not about you, this work is not about me, this work is greater than any one of us, and this work is greater than my needs. And so the church says that in all her ministries, pastoral, prophetic, and priestly, the church desires that the ministers conform to the likeness of Jesus Christ, who was himself the good shepherd. So we need to model ourselves after the good shepherd, who will go out for the sheep. One time I was going out for one sheep, and somebody wrote to me and said, "You may be going after one, but you are losing the 99. You are going after one, but you are losing the 99. Brethren, it is still right to go for the one, because that is modeling our ministry towards the life and ministry of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You know, he is the living Word of God. Jesus was there. The Bible says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word became man, and he dwelt among us. We saw him. Meaning, Jesus was the revelation of God for us, just as the scripture is. And our church, the Anglican Church of Kenya, desires that we, the ministers of the church, will be read. We will become the Word of God for the people. That the way we walk, the way we laugh, the way we talk, the way we are committed, the way we are selfless, they will say, "This is God walking in them." You know, it is said that our actions speak louder than our words. And so, brethren, we are saying we need to be the living Word of God. Let what is in the Bible come from the Bible and be seen in you. Let what is in our church be seen in you. You are a living Word. Jesus Christ is the heavenly high priest. We pray that we will be as pure and as selfless as him. We need to conform to the pattern of Jesus Christ. I would like us just to think, because of time, if three or four of you can just talk with one another for a minute and say, "These are the five things I desire to see in the ministers of the Anglican Church." Now I'm not talking about you, but about others. So just very quickly list what I would like to see in a priest, in a bishop, in the ministers within the church, are this, this, and that. They should be the character you desire to see, what you desire to see in others. And here the four of you can easily on five. Please just take 5 minutes. I want three or four or five people to talk together. One of you list the five things, what you would like to see in the life, in the character of the ministers in the church. church, the Anglican Church of Kenya, is devoted to ensuring that we conform to the likeness of Jesus Christ, because the work we are called to is God's work, called by Jesus to continue what he started to do and to teach. And so we just want to get a few samples of what we want to see in our clergy. I will give preference to the people there so that they can record yours. So we begin with them, then I come to praise and worship, then I come to the elders here, then I go back. Okay. Zeli, please report back.
What you wrote?
Hello?
Thank you. As a clergy, I expect that we be, that I.
I'm asking for what she expects of other clergy.
Yes.
What they expect of other clergy.
Yes, I expect other clergy, one, to embrace love among one another, to accommodate each other regardless of their difference in characters, to forgive and work together for the glory of God.
Amen. Hiyo tatu. Hata hawa waliandika tatu, lakini niliwaambia wapongeze. Can you present?
Praise God. So as the youths, what we expect from our clergy, number one, is that the single clergy should marry and get married.
The reason behind it is
to avoid being disturbed by groups and also to watoe jam on a little bit. Number two, we expect them to be fair. In church, you get that most of the time they are selecting people who are honored. Unakuta wenye wako na pesa, ndio ene matumbe wewe. Lakini wengine wanabaguliwa. So we expect fairness in church from our clergy. Number three is humility. Not all of them, but some are arrogant. Even the way they deal with the congregation, get that they're arrogant. So therefore, we expect humility from them. Another one, of late, most of them have been political. Instead of being spiritual. Wamesahau kazi ambayo Mungu aliwaitia. Wamekuwa political sana. So we expect new people to be more spiritual than political. Then lastly, we expect you to be appreciative. You know, a youth always get encouraged by being appreciated. When he does something, just appreciate. Hata kama ni ngumu, lakini appreciate. Thank you so much.
The youth are saying clergy need to have social intelligence so that you treat everybody in a way that builds them. Okay, the elders here. Oh, you are part of the elders.
We come to a corner by the elders. In our group, what I desire the clergy is to work as a team, to be a united team. Number two, I expect a team that is support each other, a holistic support, that is. Then number three, we expect a team that recognize the gifts of each other and utilize them. Then again, we expect a neat, presentable, and eloquent clergy. AG Canon Omolo.
Good standard.
A good standard, that is. That's why it's a canon. Then we expect clergy to live a life that is worthy. A team that prepares and delivers. When you have opportunity to deliver, you do it well. A team that prepares and delivers, a happy team. Not a team that is working like he's apologizing for his existence. Otherwise, it's a tragedy. Then a confident and competent team. A team that is accessible. Sio appointment kila wakati hawezi patikana. Then lastly, a sensitive team that needs all its, that meets the needs of its congregation. Okay.
Good. The thing is, we need to be available and willing to serve. You see, Jesus was available even to the woman of Samaria, available to the blind Bartimaeus, available to the 10 lepers. Availability and accessibility is very important for us. Now the person with the mic, I want you to go back, and any group that grabs the mic first can present. Any group now there? Okay. Please be quick.
Thank you. We'd like to have a prayerful ministers.
Yes, prayerful. And it can be easy because I will want the reporters to write all the things expected of us and at the end of the conference for us to commit ourselves to some of them.
Humble ministers.
Humble.
A minister who has knowledge of the word of God.
Musome Biblia sawa sawa, eh?
A minister with a forgiving spirit.
Yes.
A minister who can persevere and have resilience.
Resilience, yeah.
Then a minister who have genuine love among themselves.
Genuine love. In other words, genuine kida, genuine or whatever it is. Yeah, genuine love.
A minister who is hardworking and also a giver.
What?
A giver.
Giver.
The chivo.
A kikiwek manasadaka yomoko ibe igol sadaka. Okay.
A listener and someone who is able to accept correction.
Yes, be willing to listen, accept correction.
And be able to carry each other's burden.
And be available for others to cry on your shoulders. Okay?
Thank you. A minister should be passionate for ministry.
Passionate, passion. Jomoko kaloso kikia kata kidwaloso rotongi. You have to have passion.
A genuine concern for the flock, not in danger.
Yes.
Understanding of it.
Understanding?
The understanding of diversities in
a different one.
That is appreciating each other's line of ministry.
Yes.
Selflessness.
Yes.
Then peaceable.
Selflessness, peaceable, knowing the lines. He cross the path of the other person, do you ask, and go home.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I desire and I pray that we will have to see clergy to meet together for fellowship, to encourage one another, to be concerned of one another, not just meeting together for some other programs, but also meeting together to pray together, to encourage one another in Bible scriptures, and also to be concerned of one another's needs. That concern alone is very, very important. We meet together for such fellowship, not just for any other meetings and programs. Thank you.
last group. From there you will come here. You see me? From there you will bring it somewhere here.
A minister who is a role model that can be imitated by others. The team that can allow the Holy Spirit gifts to be operational.
Okay, in the middle there. Hey,
okay. Okay, we would love to see a minister who is saved. A minister who is living a practical life. A minister who is having that genuine humility. I think those three others have been said.
Okay, lovely. Any more things that have not been said? There are only what has not been said, even if it is one.
Thank you. I would like to add a minister who is of good moral standing.
Good moral standing. The youth who are joining Kiku Tag in the Neos Kennedy. Yeah, moral standing.
And you also want to add, he must not be a lover of money.
Do not be a lover of money, yes. For the love of money is the root of all evil.
And finally, we also want to add, must be truthful in general. Thank you. Truthful.
Truthful, yes, truthful, lovely. Any other which have not been said is what? There, the culture. Only a few which have not been said.
We would love to see a minister who is bold to the world, facing challenges as they are, and also bold to the world, teaching what is there in the Bible.
Boldness and living in reality, not in a utopia. Any they come. Finish that, then there is man at the back, then you come to the front. Okay, Reverend Margaret.
We would also love to see a minister who has a good mental health.
Good mental health. You come out to 20 POP or very much. Yes. Then you come to the front.
A minister.
Yesterday I said, in Anglican church we prefer consultation. communication and consensus building. Okay?
A minister who is able to protect one another.
Yeah.
And a minister who is a good steward of time.
Good, your time has been set, but having the back of your brothers, having the back of your sisters, when anybody says anything, you say, my brother cannot do that, then you go and find out. You don't join them in the gossip. Okay, there was one more here. Yeah, okay.
For us, we'd love to see a real priest devoid of stereotypes, e.g. wearing face mask and face hands. A real priest.
What is baffling me? How will I know the real priest?
With us in our group. Hello? Let us continue.
Yes.
So within my group, we expect a minister who can embrace positive attitude. When he's posted somewhere or is given any responsibility, he does not complain.
A positive attitude. It is your attitude, not your aptitude, that will determine your altitude. We know Kisumu alone. It is your attitude, not your aptitude, that will determine your altitude. Hallelujah. Positive. Don't ever take on it. Very good. Coronio, we know what we ought to do. Let us do it. For so, Anglicans definitely know. You ask the young, they'll tell you. Some people were with me at a Sunday school conference, and I asked them to describe what a clergy should do. And the little children were telling me exactly what you people are saying here. So in our church, we know what we ought to do. Now, the will to do it in our own day, to will no ema kori duongo, niye monoroho juaki. Let us allow the Holy Spirit to enable us to do what we ought to do. I hope you will condemn some of those things for me, because as I finish the last 5 minutes, you will give me major one, and I will commit these people, our friends, to it. The second point I want to look at is in the second clause of the article that I read. The second clause of the article that I read. It is clause 2, and it says, no one order, no one office in the church can claim exclusive possession of any one of these ministries or of all. That simply means we have prophetic ministries, pastoral ministry, priestly ministry, and various other ministries. We are saying, although we are an ordered ministry, no one order can claim to possess all the gifts and the right for them. You cannot say that it is only the bishop who should speak truth to power. That prophetic word is not dominated by the office of the bishop. It is not only the vicar who can reach out for people who are hurting. That ministry is not exclusively for the priest. Other people can go on. What this will help on is blame shifting. When we fail to do what we ought to do, we always look up to the bishops are quiet, the clergy are quiet, the archdeacons are doing nothing. People are cutting our bishop and the archdeacons are not protecting him. And the late Charles Owadi used to say that an archdeacon, a coke bishop, the archdeacon should be the weeping boy. And but we are saying it is not taking all the authority. These authorities are exercised in various offices, but other offices can also come in. So there is no excuse when we fail, because we can work together. So it goes on to say that every Christian, yes, every Christian, by his or her baptism, is a member of the body and belong to each other. Therefore, he or she has been committed in his due order and proportion, a share of responsibility for the life of the church. That is, be you lay or ordained, you have been apportioned a share of your responsibility for the life of the church and for its ministries, for all its ministries. Let me ask this. In that closes talking of the ministry of the whole church. So what is the role of the ordained minister in the Anglican church insofar as the ministry of all believers is concerned? The point I'm raising is every member of the Anglican church must be enabled to serve God and to build the church. Now what I'm asking, what is the ordained minister's responsibility in enabling that? May I get responses? Yes? Please.
Mentorship.
Oh, yeah. Mentorship. Lovely. Mentorship. Let me check. How many senior clergy are here? I'm leaving the bishops for a while. But other senior by ordination, I'm leaving all other titles. Any senior person here, just raise up your hand. Yes, I know Isaac is senior, and others. Let's see that in the cabeza. Seniors. Could the seniors stand up, please? The seniors just stand up. Na moda umutomiano se bedo bimbo bimbo tere. Seniors. Okay. Let me now ask. Seniors, please. How many of you, hey, how many of you senior people have held the hands of young people from high school, nurtured them in the youth, and until now they are ordained? How many have some of them? All of them, you are wonderful people. You are good mentors. I wouldn't. Your man who will manage a problem. They are not mentors. You see, the seniors have held, and I know some of the seniors, so I can agree that they have done that. Mentorship. Paul Timothy relationship. Hello? How many of you now, I'm not now talking to seniors, How many of you have somebody in Form 2 whom he is or she is mentoring? Somebody in Form 2? You stand up, those with Form 2 mentees. Just stand up. Yes, sir. Ololo, I'm sure because you are in school ministry. Martin also, I know. And let's sample, ladies. What are you doing with the person? Can you take the microphone to Ayana?
I am paying her school fees.
Yes.
And also mentoring her.
Yes.
For the ministry.
So most likely, that person will one day tell you, I want to be like you. And in your mentorship, you should look at their skills, their gifting, and advise appropriately. Meaning, take them through until they do everything they can do, not only becoming like a priest. What are you doing with that form too? What's her name, by the way? What's her name?
Ashi.
What are you doing with that?
For now, I'm doing the guidance and counseling.
Yes. Yeah. You are giving guidance and counseling. Give to Benina.
My daughter is Mercy Molin.
Yes.
Yeah?
Mercy
Molin Abu.
Which school?
Mayeka Secondary School.
Mayeka, what are you doing with that?
I'm paying the school fees and taking care of her psychologically, physically, and spiritually.
Yeah, supporting. Yeah. Let's have a pause, eh?
Thank you, Bishop. It's Cynthia of Wabasa Girls. We have been charged on while we pay our fee. We meet her regularly for mentorship sessions, both spiritual matters and matters of our academics. And she has remained top of that class.
Yes. Individual discipleship is very powerful. So we need to do. Now let me see those who are mentoring boys. Because so far it is only girls who are being mentored. Who are mentoring boys? Yes. Yeah, boys, the girl mentors can sit now.
Praise God.
Amen.
I mentor both girls and boys.
Yes.
And especially everybody is allowed to take it.
No, tell me one specific boy.
Specific boys?
Yeah.
I've mentored the boys.
When
I was in a lab class, I mentored a boy who is ready for settle.
Then you stopped your mentorship when you left the lab.
Even at the moment, I continue.
You are continuing thinking.
Is in Form 2.
Yeah.
We are paying his school fees, ensuring all the basic needs schools are taken care of, and I follow his performance frequency. When last time he brought me the result, I went through with him the result.
Okay.
Yes.
Very good. One more.
Thank you. I'm mentoring a boy with some Kisumu boys, and we are paying for his school fee. And after doing all this, I make sure that I visit him and he visits me so that I see how he is prospering.
Many of you are acting as surrogate parents because mentorship is a little more than paying school fees and meeting the needs and all that. But those are very valuable. It's a step towards mentorship. Mentorship means training somebody to move towards a certain direction. thank you very much, because we need that mentorship. I would like now to say that in our church, all the orders of ministry are important and they support each other. I believe that we must mentor the laity to do the work of service. That is Ephesians chapter 4. The Bible says that all these ministries are given so that we can equip the saints for work of service. Equipping, equipment for work of service. Meaning, you are actually leaders in your parishes, in your docket, you are leaders, and leadership role is to do with equipping other people. Miles Monroe defines leadership as the ability and will to mobilize, to motivate, and inspire people who work with you or in your group, to inspire them to reach goals that will be beneficial to them and to the organization. So your work as a leader within the Anglican Church is one to do with mobilization. Praise the Lord. Amen. Two, to do with motivation. And the youth here was saying, one thing that motivates them is when you appreciate them. So we need to use that tool of appreciation in motivating people to do what they ought to do. And to inspire confidence, inspire people to be able to reach where they ought to reach. That is why one group said positivity is key to your ministry. Because when you give up, everybody will give up. When you are positive, everybody will, of course not everybody, but majority of people will be inspired. What are some of the things you do to inspire people? I just want three people to share with me. As a priest, as a leader of a parish or an archdeaconry or deanery, what are the tools for inspiration? How do you inspire? Yes, Archdeacon Ruth.
I think first of all we need to do motivation, yes, so that they get inspired.
I'm asking how you do it. How? You first motivate. How do you motivate? How do you?
Affirmation by affirming them.
What?
Affirmation.
Affirmation. Thank you. One affirmation. We should be affirming even the Tukutenderes, our brethren. Majority of clergy criticize the Tukutenderes as brethren and do not inspire or motivate or encourage or appreciate. We need to change and begin to attend fellowship. How many of you go to fellowship? Very good. Anyway, it doesn't mean if you don't go, you don't encourage. You can still encourage. Okay.
Yes, one of the ways in which we can inspire them is to give them chances. Like, give them a chance to participate, to preach. Just give them a room.
Yes, you can first equip, then give. But even before you equip, you can challenge somebody. In 2 weeks' time, you will be reading in church. So they go and practice. You can challenge then in 2 weeks' time you will be preaching. And they will try. There are a few people here who got surprised when I told them to go and take certain assignments in preaching and all that. But it's a way of encouraging and inspiring people to go on. So, you are a leader. You must inspire your people. You must move them to the next level. I want each one of you just to write in your book, yourself, individually. Write, what kind of support do you need from your bishop? And the support I need from my bishop is salary increase. The support I need from my bishop is this. Just write, write that. Moja tu. Moja tu. The support you need from your bishop. Stand up. Only two. Very good. Now all of those can say, we begin with you. Just read what you wrote. Don't modify, just read.
Support in service. Support in service. What I want to give an example.
Yeah.
And I need a microphone.
Right.
Have gone to rest with the Lord in terms of their education.
Okay, good. A little bit support for the family of the clergy. Organize programs, come up with ways of giving support for children of clergy to thrive. Last one.
Yes, thank you, Your Lordship. I desire that my Lord Bishop bring unity in my life, as in holistically, when I'm not healthy, mentally. And then, because of family issues.
Yes.
Because of family
issues. Yes. You are right.
Thank you.
You mean counseling?
Yes, exactly.
Counseling, eh?
Through my Lord Bishop.
You need your bishop to visit your home, eh?
Exactly.
Very good. The bishop was a leader. Love you. So, brethren, I know clergy need support. But I also know that the seniors, the bishops also need support. I want to put the bishops on the spot and ask them to tell me the support they need from the clergy. Bishops, kindly. This is rare, but you know, it is only in the Anglican Church where bishops are human beings. Some of them know it, and some of them have wives to remind them that they are human beings. So, brethren, what support do you need?
Another one will name now. Tojiwa.
Yes. Actually, you may not know, the only person from Nyanza who went to pray for Archbishop Gitari when he was in real problems was Canon Odanga. He's now retired. And Archbishop called me and told me, you know, all my ministry, nobody has ever come to pray for me. And today, a young man from Southern Nyanza came and I asked him, do you need a scholarship? He said, no. What do you need me to help you with? Nothing. Why have you come? I've come to pray for you. And he prayed for him, and then Gitari gave him his driver to take him back to the bus, and he came back to Southern Nyanza. Only one clergy in the whole province who went to pray for Archbishop Gitari. The others were backbiting him. The others were saying very ugly things about him. So prayer and encouragement is necessary. Another bishop, I will not force you, that's where you feel like.
You know, we must respect our elders.
We are human. When I make a mistake in a statement, I will be pulled to like a clergy who will be able to paraphrase my mistake. It's like I may say something which is not good. In the spur of the moment of what has made me to say it. But then this clergy who will be able to say what the bishop meant was this. And then you will say something that is positive. That is one. Two, a clergy who, because of others, we will be able to see the non-verbals of what I'm doing, and will find time to come and see me, pray with me, and fellowship with me, and tell me that I understand your challenge. If I were in your shoes, I'd be able to do this and this and this. So I'd be able to say his point, perhaps it's what others are saying, and learn to what I'm also doing.
Thank you. I like the last one, which is feedback. Brethren, in our church, we are joined together. When the clergy fails, the bishop has failed. When the bishop fails, the clergy have failed. And the laity have failed. So feedback. And for us, because we've gone to school, you can do synthesized feedback. You can go and modify whatever you've had and say, maybe that one we may need to improve on this. Let it be feedback, but that is more palatable. Not like the feedback that ranks around your home would do. Come and say, Nikilemo to beonge. That is a negative kind of feedback, but again, feedback. So it's important. Any other bishop wants to say?
Thank you. Hey, one of my lot. For me, I would like the lady to be honest with me. A number of them speak differently when they are away and when they are near you.
My Lord Bishop.
Thank you, what you know. My Lord is the Malich. They say different things. Some of them are very similar. So please be honest. When you are saying something, what you are saying before us is what you can say also outside as well. We'll be bringing our culture to be more progressive in it here. All will be well if we do that.
Yes. Good. I think I like that. Honesty is very good. And there are say we do. Kikalo kamoro majiki ya mintie, tiwijo kanyichota chota ningenu wa songano herokale. Kikicho, hoja duro.
I think this is the climax of the conference where the clergy asked what they need from their bishops and bishops what they need from the clergy. I think we need one another because the ministry is for all of us. Except that we play different roles. So what in my own reflection is that there is no one who is greater than the other. Except that God has given us different roles to play. One, we can't have all of us playing the same role simultaneously unless it's a parish ministry. So what we request is that we become honest with one another in terms of ministry. I wish to have a clergy who has the courage to make an appointment with me and say, this is the way I'm feeling. So he or she gets it from me. No bishop, I want to believe that bishop should not hate his life. And if there is any hatred, there's something is wrong with the two parties. Like a child, sometimes you crack the whip, but you do it with love. And when you are doing it, when you crack, only the dark side of you is being pronounced. But by the time you are exercising grace, they go mute about it. Let's acknowledge that in as much as some of us may be extremely administrative, more than pastoral in your life, we still need to support each other's ministry. Today it is me, tomorrow it is you. The way you treat me, that the same way when also God, by His grace, gives you that position, we also want to be treated in the same manner. So I think it is a question of mutual respect and understanding our calling. Thank you.
Yeah, let me just say that leadership within our structure is consultative and facilitative. And the role of the bishop is to facilitate you and you consult both the bishop and one another. Any other bishop wants to speak?
Now, in addition,
coming to the in addition to the many things that they have said, the support that I would want for my clergy. I'm actually in addition to the many that they have said, but Herauru Kakaheru Manomoko Marariote Ningea Mate Ningea Nahu Noto Kamanani to Oduagi Coconut Timana to Ringela Edeno. You say Ningea, you get my Kakangor and eat out too. Dadunani, Dadunani, eating, eating. Kama, regarding a Kakajatel, or dwelling. My note is proven my own new one. Amen.
I think what Bishop is saying is take cue and follow the leadership, follow the guidance. Bishop Professor Konya also said that people have different strengths and different emphases. One may emphasize compliance and things to be done in a straight manner. What Bishop John Mark is saying is follow that line. Follow your leader. Know your leader. You know, Jesus said that a good shepherd knows the sheep, and the sheep hears his voice. Watemuru, and sometimes we may be very busy, but there are times when you are just contemplating. You need to know when you can burst into the bishop's office and just tell him this. The padre so long ago used to have a unique courage. One time, Reverend Ogundo from Yuma, the old Ogundo, not the new one, just busted into Bishop Okulo's office and said, I want to see the bishop. And the secretary was telling him, he's still busy. And he says, I'm calling me to go, and I'm not going to bishop. He goes into the office, sits in and begins to quarrel. Bishop, I thought you were wise, but it appears you are not wise. Inemanuke ni Kisumu, kora mingyo, niluwa gendo Kisumu. Chakuthi di geda semu, ukinyal gendo Kisumu, niketu mamu turu nitiyemi. And then he just walked out and left the bishop there. Accept you the way you are. So your personality is known. But courage to know when to burst in and say, Abana, Jaduomu mato negimi. To okidwani Jaduomu query. So you go out very quickly, Mondo kikoyudurum to say me, na pare kama. Because you don't want to hear that. You deliver your message and off you go. Bishops, thank you very much, because our ministry, you cannot be able to help people if you do not know their mind. I want to read now clause 3b. Clause 3b says this: the church therefore holds that no person shall be accounted or taken to be a lawful bishop, lawful priest, or deacon in this church, or permitted to assume any of these offices, except that such persons be called, tried, examined, train and prepared for the sacred ministry and admitted there unto according to an ordinal approved in accordance with the Article 2, or has already had episcopal consecration or ordination, the validity of which has been approved by the provincial synod, which shall have power to delegate its power to approve to the House of Bishops or to the Episcopal Synod. What I want to pick out of that is formation for ministry. How do we form our people? We need to help all the laity to play their role effectively, and then create an atmosphere that will make them receive call for more ministry. Just like I was saying yesterday, that the worship of the Anglican Church should be conducted in such a way that the poetry of the Psalms come out, the good music come out, the good reading and the preaching homilies come out, to a point that people get to a level that they want to fall in love with God. And at that level, somebody will be feeling a higher calling. Let us create desire in our people to serve God in various places. Let me just use Mr. Now, Canon Venerable Mill. Canon Venerable Mill, I started to interact with him when he was a school teacher. Good, just sit down. But I was always interested in him, and whenever we were teaching or doing things, you try to encourage to see if he can open up. So create an environment to make people desire to serve God in the Anglican Church. Today, we have people who would have been serving God elsewhere, but some of us brought them back. So what I'm saying is, let us create an environment of nurture and help people begin to desire to work in the church. And you know, when you help people do that, their calling will be clear. So the clause is saying, the person must be called. Then, tested. I want to very quickly ask, how many of you within the last 5 years have processed anybody to go for training to be a clergy? Last 5 years, up to now, 5 years, you have processed them, okay, to help them to come to be clergy. What are the steps you use in processing and helping people to come to the ordained ministry? Does somebody give me what are the steps? I'm doing that because I know Bishop Onginjo was troubled for many years. He didn't know how to become a priest, and he really desired. How many years did Room Kitchen? 5 years. Kokiyanga ma nyalo meta e orini se kakibedo padri. So I just want somebody to tell me, I'm thinking of formation.
The ones that I have processed,
yes,
began with first fellowship with me.
Yes.
To understand what they mean by being called.
Yes.
Then the second step was to take them, introduce my fellowship with that person to the parish executive.
Yes.
There I got the opinions of the members of the person concerning, and the members of the executive concerning that person.
Mm-hmm.
And I did ask the person then to appear before the council of the church.
Yes.
Then after the appearance of the church, the parish clears that person.
Yes.
Then I took them to the deanery council.
Yes.
And after the deanery council, then I take the details of that person, of his desire, to the diocese, specifically to the office of the vicar general, who later will process them to call and identify more. That is the process I follow.
Yeah, I know your environment is one church, one parish. Yes, that is the correct one. Anybody from the rural, where you have six congregations or more, the step you take? One person to tell me, what do you do? Yes, there is a person there.
Thank you. Usually the candidate will come to approach me to have a fellowship with the team or her. Then I'll refer him to his or her local church. That committee will discuss him and then give recommendation which I'll follow and have a further discussion with the committee. Then after some consultation, I'll table that recommendation before the Parish Council.
Good, there we are correct. How about if the local evangelist refuses? I think Naftali had an experience like that. How about if the local church refuses? What do you do? Can I get some suggestions? Because it is true they can. Because some young people may even go to the bishop before they go to the padre. Then when the bishop sends them down, bishop, what do you do? Naftali, you want to share? Okay.
Maybe my story.
Yes, yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
When I got born again, I didn't care anything except walking with Jesus and sharing the testimony of Christ wherever opportunity was. That brought me to fellowship with people across board, not strictly within the Anglican Church. I connected myself to student ministry through Kenya Students Christian Fellowship, and that kind of engaged me with a number, some of whom were Pentecostal. And so the Pentecostal and Anglican mix was not yet accepted at that time. So when I tried my bid to get into Bible school, having got the call, the local church, actually not really the local church, but a particular member who felt influential, he was then a member of synod at the diocese and was secretary in that church. He equipped the entire council to drop my bid and say, unless I'm willing to change and detach myself from those other denominations, then I have no future in Anglican ministry. Which I took. Definitely it hurt me because I love my church with a passion. It hurt me very deeply. It made me feel rejected by those that I believe knew me more. And so it sent me kind of to retreat for a while. And in that retreat, somebody somewhere identified the gift of God in me and invited me. I had gone for a mission, and Reverend Paul Nehemiah, I think somebody talked about, Canon Omolo talked about Paul Nehemiah Onyango, and Canon Ni Kajuoga, now he's in the United States. They identified me and asked me to come and join that parish ministry in Gotosimbo to follow up nurture, and continue to reach out. So I was given a stint in that parish, a very informal arrangement, but I served for 1 year with very deep dedication. And I think it is during that time that I got exposed to my Lord, the Bishop Joseph. When Paul Nehemiah should have addressed the Cairo conference in Ramba, and he became sick with typhoid, he asked me to go and represent him in the session he was supposed to do. And so when I went, that's the first time Bishop Wasonga sat in the congregation and saw me minister in an epilogue. It was just an epilogue one night. And so after it, Bishop, you may not remember, but I remember you asking me, opening service Samapogosa. Bishop, I had to borrow robes from Ramba Church. Somebody somehow gave me a cassock and a surplice, and I preached from John chapter 2, verse 11. And from there, you ordered Jonathan Yahuma, who was both DYO and the dean of Botosibodina, where I was serving under Paul Nehemiah, and you told him, go get in touch with Padre of Botosimbo and see if you can bring Naftali's papers to me. The rest is history, and today I am here.
So, I want to move on quickly and finish, but the reason I brought this is that our ministry is continuum. Therefore, we must always be preparing people to get into the ministry. Mentorship is important. I know the late Canon Okelo mentored John Nyesi, mentored Canon Okoyo, and mentored many others. And Okelo's method, even Asewe was mentored by him. His method was to take you to places he's going to preach, sometimes let you sing, sometimes let you give a testimony. That is exposing you. So let's expose some of these young people within what they can do to prepare them. The next point I wanted to check, how then do we ensure that the desired people are the ones who are trained, and once they have been trained, they are trained on the job, meaning when you are placed in a parish, is it experience or there is a word now they use, internship, eh? When you are taken for internship, probably the bishops may need to draw together, because in this region, we work together to draw perimeters of internship. Because I see in some places, the interns are just missionary travelers. Kinyoni loka, jumachie loyalo, odhi kamoro jumachie, odhi kamoro jumbe ario, and all that. And I wonder whether there is a curriculum for mentorship, for internship, because it should be something that can be evaluated at the end of the internship to help. Let me also encourage us, because when we are together, we can maybe come up with financing for training of future pastors. Financing for training of future pastors. And I would encourage that in this area, we get at least one college where we will take all our pastors at least for 1 year. They can get their degree anywhere or something anywhere. But I think it is important, if we want to form these people as Anglicans, we may choose, the bishops may choose one college and check the curriculum and say, we are not only teaching Anglicanism, but we are teaching ministry in the context of Lake Region. Because ministry in our context may be different from ministry in other contexts. I'm throwing that for the next house of bishops to think through it, and then you people, because many of us are trained in diverse environments and we do not have the same kind of orientation. Now, because time is going, I want to ask, how would you like your clergy to appear in public? I want these young people to tell me. How would you like your clergy to appear in public? Is anyone ready to share? If you are not, no pressure. Anybody who wants to tell me, how should your clergy appear in public? An Anglican clergy. Hey, tell me, yes? I'm talking about decorum. Decorum of the Anglican priest.
I feel that an Anglican clergy should appear in public as somebody who is like a leader. You know, a leader is there for service. So humble is the one. A servant.
Humility?
A servant. Yes, humble.
Servant. Humble, okay. Physically, what will show you is humble. She is humble.
Yes, physically, he or she should be decent.
Decent. What will make him or her, he or she, be decent?
It comes with the title that you hold.
Yes.
So that makes you
also. So I should be walking around telling people I'm the reverend. it's okay. Let's get somebody. Last one.
Thank you so much. I expect an Anglican clergy to appear before the public when he is somebody who is ready and prepared, in the sense that you know the people you are going to talk to and the issues you are going to handle, so you get prepared.
How will I know you are prepared?
The way you present yourself.
How?
One is about the boldness.
Yes.
Yes. And good. The courage.
Thank you. Last one from here.
As an Anglican clergy, I expect to see a neat dressed mode.
Yeah.
Not putting on a collar shirt, left loose hanging with a pipe trouser.
Yeah. What is saying? There is a dress code that is necessary for an Anglican clergy. You know, some of us here, and I think I know most of the bishops, some of us here do not like putting on jackets. But they do, because people have an image. They want to see you neatly dressed. So dress code. Many years ago, at a liturgical conference in Mombasa, the whole country, we discussed the kind of dressing for clergy. And about three kind of color of shirts were recommended. They said clergy can have a black shirt and evangelical collar if the Holy Spirit is in you, eh? You have an evangelical collar like mine. mondo roho tugo to inyalo neni back and front kata kiwuotho. Not the Roman collar, minyalo soyo fuko, sa midwago kona kona. But anyway, they said, they said black. Secondly, they said gray, but you know, yeah, I think Isaac has the gray, yeah, this gray, yeah, Marin Yosebuto Matino, but I'm gray. I'm talking in the color, in the longer, when you're again, gray, but it's gray was the second. Then there is a black and gray for Clyde. Then they said blue, but then all the people from Nyanza rejected the blue. They said Mano Marijonomia and other people. So we said Nyanza will not have blue. We had said only gray and black. Then they said archdeacon. Yes, they are administrators. In any an administrator at the office, it was registratima either Rajaruru or gray. Because those are royal colors. So we agreed archdeacon will adorn the white one. But anyway, somewhere down the line, I think that line has been blurred and some people, I've seen a few clergy with white, and also I like white, although I put some purple on it, but it's basically white. So I will request the bishop to come up with a guidance. Maybe they have already done in their own diocese, but it would be better when we come together and say, Kiriyeliye, toirwa korikama, tokokiro, togikivi bed, e olta kumayoma robe nitie. Akianu winja, so that there is kaana anagishati like me, when I appear in my collar and not robe, I feel embarrassed when you force me to sit in the front. Because I come knowing I want to be in the congregation. So if you are a good person, you just arrange tomorrow, my dignitaries, including your clergy friends and bishops, will see. So that we don't meet. Ni udolta ngato nigi sati, tongato bende bushat, tongato bende su tomorrow bende miluoko kupi. And it's not very decent. Suto mego teri alone we but anyway, what I'm saying, order. There should be order in how we do our thing. Kao hiyo mununyana wako white, I have no problem, but let us do it in order. So that next region Wakoni, we are agreed. I'm sorry, people from Upper South and Nyanza, I spoke to you a little bit more. But what I'm saying is that we need to be identifiable as an Anglican. That is important. I also know these days people wear crosses. And I know Maseno South and Maseno West did it because of Crucillo, Bishop Francis agreed that clergy would wear these crosses. Maseno West, I also think we discussed it in clergy chapter. We even went to the synod and told them we could. That, again, our bishops can agree if it is something we are doing. Some of us wear crucifix. Anglicans don't wear crucifix. But I've seen two or three clergy with a crucifix. You know the difference between a cross and a crucifix? Yes. we can agree that we have a standard. Then we also agree that the cross should not be as long as narrow needle. It should not be exaggerated and too long. It should be a certain size which people can see and say, oh, yes, you are a clergy. You are a clergy. But then I have been greeted by people kneeling because they have seen sometimes I put a cross that is not a crucifix but looks like that of the Roman. And in a supermarket, somebody comes, holds my hand, kisses my ring and kneels down, thinking I'm a Roman Catholic bishop. And then I would explain, I'm a Catholic, but not Roman. So they would know and say, ah, that only you are good and all that. So what I'm saying is standard of dressing, where our fathers in God can, and mothers in God can direct, but then we must then adhere to that so that we look neat. John, kata jomo pidho tik gino kwadwar gato tinde. Keto bishops be ma pidho tik gimboro wangwe niya. We can excuse that one, but tik gino must be neat. It must be neat. Kiko pedi machale machale nige. Obeye abiti. Obeye. I'm sorry, that's just a joke. Give me a minute to go. Yes.
I have a concern on dressing. Especially, we have adopted the use of gown. And sometimes we go the technical way, and you find most of us dress with a convocation attire, and then you put the liturgical colors. Kindly, can you help us understand this?
Actually, I have a lot of notes on that. What we need to accept is that we have different kinds of robes. Convocational or Victorian for clergy is a castle. Am I correct? Yes, black castle. Then white surplice. And surplice can be long or short, but neatly done. And then a tippet. Black tippet. That is black scarf, eh? Preacher's scarf. That one for evangelical church is really the cloth for the clergy. And I think to make things simpler, when we go into gatherings, that should be our standard. I think so, but our fathers and mothers in law will have to advise, but I think that is the way. Let's keep to it. It looks nice. Our days, we used to add the hood to show that you've gone to school. Yeah, we would add the hood. These days, it's not fashionable. But I would that when you are burying a professor, you put on the hood. Like when we were burying John Nyesi, all of us who know had our hoods on. Just to honor that this is a learned man. Of course, hoods were the beggar's bag in those days. You would just walk around and people put something for you and you don't see who has put what, so that your prayer is uniform. You don't pray for one who has given a lot, a little bit more, and the other. It used to be, but it has taken the academic form and the church form. But simple, Victorian dress. And I first saw it in America, where there was the confusion that you have the Victorian and then you put on the liturgical colors on it. I even got into that confusion the very early days of my episcopacy. You could see at the burial of Bishop Okulu, I had the convocation of black attire, but I also put the liturgical color, but I've corrected myself. So I think, let's be simple, keep it at that. Then, when you come to Eucharist, again in Maseno West, we went and talked to the clergy and we agreed that you can wear a chasuble, but only when you are the chief celebrant. Again, Winda, you can wear a chasuble only when you are the chief celebrant, which means I may be a canon double, or I may be an archdeacon double, but when I'm in the service, I'm not presiding. I don't wear anything else apart from my convocation. And these days I see canons wearing canon robes at divine service. I don't think it's advisable. But again, bishops can sit and look at it. Because the canon robes are robes of honor. It is a robe of honor. But when it comes to divine service, we do it correctly. The chief celebrant will have the chasuble. In strict Anglican circles, the chasuble is not a processional dress. The chasuble is not a processional dress. It is put on the holy table, and when you are coming now to begin the great service, then you put it on at that time, at the table. You should have a warden or a chaplain who will make sure you put it. When I was a bishop, I would process with copper and mitre, but then the chasuble is on the table. So when I'm going to celebrate, I simply put it on there, do it. When I'm processing out, I leave it in the church and process with what I should. And I think those are the comments. I wonder if one bishop has a comment on that before I close. Anyone wants to say anything about it, Onyango, Bishop?
Thank you. The tradition that we seem to have developed of having the chasuble on the cast of iron at funerals is something that we also need to agree. The Roman Catholic, they would adorn the chasuble and the cast of iron because within their tradition, they are used to having the Eucharist. So if I was going to have Eucharist, that would be okay. But if there's no Eucharist, I need to just be in my convocation.
That bishop, that even where there is, when there is Holy Communion at the Mass of the Dead, the Anglicans, how do we call it? Catholics call it Mass of the Dead. Ritual Mass simply means Mass of the Dead. Yeah, but it is a Mass, meaning they are celebrating Communion, and for them, they are correct, they wear that, and they have agreed all the bishops there and all the clergy can wear. That is their tradition. Let us not go to it. But if you have Holy Communion and you are the chief celebrant, it is okay. Don't process. I would still say you don't process in the chasuble, but you leave it at the altar. When you are beginning the communion, put it on, and then it will work. Brothers and sisters, there are so many things we would look at, but I really wish I could get a list. Can you give me a summary of the things we agreed we expect from clergy? Just a few. I don't want a lot of them. I hope I can read this and write it. And, or maybe Martin will help me. Okay, good. Embrace positive attitude. Mano ye go. Hey, embrace positive attitude. Mano ye go. Real priest, not a pretender. I don't know how that will be. But don't be a pretender to the throne. Always follow the constitution. Okay. An Anglican priest is expected to pass the following values. Number one, be loving and forgiving to others. Do we agree with that?
Yes.
Be humble. Agreed?
Yes.
Be appreciative.
Yes.
Agreed?
Yes.
Embrace unity.
Yes.
Agreed?
Yes.
Recognize other potentials and tap them for God's glory. Yes, just recognize other people's talent and gifts and use them. Be prayerful. Have knowledge of God's word. Meaning we detected some clergy, then be a giver, be a passionate of his or her word. Be a saved person. I don't know what that means, but be a saved person. Have good moral standing. Have moral standing. High, not low. Let me see those who are committed to high moral standards. Yeah, so high moral standard. That is very, very important. Be mentally sound. Tiendania, personal care. Yesterday when the Archbishop Betty was talking about mental health, she was also talking of personal care. Please, clergy, drink a lot of water. Do you drink water?
Yes.
Can drink water to tero gigo the right direction of wogigogi. Are you getting me? On the smell that comes from your stomach, if you drink water, they will go the right direction. And even when you fart, it will not be smelly. So it will be quite good. Drink a lot of water. And then, grooming. Kailuora bondo tilielwi Jordan. To kailchayo bondo kaan, let it be neat. Katodong yera reo an, wadadwa kip magagi, katagin yera reo kalia. Because aerobedo rabondo. So, you need to groom. Eating well is important. Then giwacho kae ni be accountable. Accept correction. Be a good listener and accept correction. Be available. And then be good steward of time. Be consultative, be approachable, be of positive attitude, do not be money lovers. Kikuheri pesa joete, but uduar pesa to kikuheri.
be faithful. And let me say, please, take off days. If you do not take off days, Nikumano has another thing. Take off days. You need to rest your mind. You need to have a change. This day something is developing that is baffling me. That clergy call meetings on Monday. The day when they should be resting, they should be reading at home, they should be kissing their wives or husbands, and they are going for meetings. I don't understand. I don't really understand that. And one time I lost votes from Western because I refused to attend a meeting on Monday. I didn't need those votes. Because you need to self-care. Take time off, pray, groom, and be with your wife. If you are married, kiss her properly. If you are a married woman, have time migono lebdolo. Kikime the padri nichuori, bed la konichuori, so that he can enjoy you and say nikara the koma padri ber moloyo moko. Just be yourself. Let me stop there. May God bless you.